What's up, what's up, what's up, everybody? How y'all doing? How y'all doing? This your boy Cut Calhoun, and welcome to another episode, week six of Truth Be Told, Meaning Behind the Music. And this week we're covering By the Liquor Store off the Truth Be Told Persona Non Grata album. I'm a couple of days late, but better late than never. You know what I'm saying? So we're going to cover Down by the Liquor Store. And what we're going to do is listen to a few bars right now, and then we're going to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and I hope that this is a blessing to you or somebody that you may know. Let's listen. Everybody that's tuning in right now. By the liquor store. What's up, y'all?
Black Smitty used to post up on the wall. Every time he bust a head, told me look out for them laws. Peanut and Teddy used to drink that Parmesan. Had a plethora of hoes and taught me how to talk to dogs. My nigga Chess, he knew how to fix your car. Smoke, crack, and entertain. Guess that nigga did it all. And Uber Ray had the gallons of that water. Supplied the whole city. He was what you call a baller. I learned to hustle, crack, and watch for police. And talk clever to get a bitch to do whatever I need. Had to hook up with a mechanic who would barter for D. And a baller that I can call to send me up in these streets. Get found by the liquor store.
All right, y'all. All right, y'all. So, that's Down by the Liquor Store. That's what we'll be covering, man. I'm grateful. I'm thankful. I'm doing all right. I hope everybody out there is doing right and having a blessed day today. You know what I'm saying? All praises to God. You know what I'm saying? Our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Thank Him for waking me up this morning and allowing me to be present here to go ahead and give you another episode of Persona Non Grata, Truth Be Told, covering week six, Down by the Liquor Store. Now, Down by the Liquor Store, man. Basically, that song came about, and what it's about, the concept of Down by the Liquor Store is basically saying, when you grow up in a fatherless home, for those that have grew up in fatherless homes that maybe just grew up with your mother, or maybe those that had a mom and dad, but you didn't stay at home because you was either rebellious or things wasn't going right at home. Down by the liquor store, if you've ever lived in the inner city, if you ever lived in a more urbanized area or, low income housing area, the hood, so have you, or whatever, you know, the liquor store is a spot where you can gain a lot of knowledge by the liquor store if you soak it up the right way. The liquor store, down in the city anyways, maybe not now in suburban areas and whatnot, but down in the cities, majority of the time you got people hanging out by the liquor stores. And the liquor stores that I'm accustomed to seeing, you know, they had people hanging out in front of there, whether it was a person that was a drunk or a couple of drunks hanging out there, maybe some drug addicts that was out there, maybe some people that was hustling out there. And, when you got all those type of people that's hanging around liquor stores, you got people that's hustling, people that's selling weed, people that's selling crack, people that's selling whatever they can make some money off of. And then you got people out there that's just winos and people that just drink and whatnot. You know what I'm saying? All those people have been through something. All those people have lived a life, and all those people got something to say. So if you've ever been in a position like me, you can gain a lot of knowledge from those type of people. You should never judge anybody. You never know, you might be entertaining angels, you know what I'm saying? So you should always, just because somebody is doing worse than you, or they may look like a bum or stink or just look scruffy and raggedy, you never know that person's life that they've been through or whatever. And so at the liquor store, you got these different personalities, and if you can soak it in and analyze it or whatever, you can gain something from it. And what I gained from my experiences by the liquor store was that you had people down there that talk to you about hustling, their views on hustling. You know, you had people that wanted to teach you how to make some money and stay out of trouble or avoid the police, or how to bag up something. You know what I'm saying? In their eyes, they was giving you some positive some positive information or something that was going to protect you, but nonetheless, it was positive in their eyes to try to help you move further in whatever you was doing. You had people that would talk to you about women, you know, you listen to these stories, people got ways and advice and suggestions and opinions about, how to talk to women. I learned a lot of things that I've accrued over the years from, people on the street, you know what I'm saying? Like I said before, I didn't have a daddy in my home. And so I learned a lot of what I know from other people on the street that kind of took the role as father figures, because I didn't have a father in my house per se that was just raising me in the house. And so a lot of the information I got, it came out from people that was on the streets and that was at my house. I used the liquor store as a metaphor because I wasn't personally at the liquor store like that every day. And I used names of family members of mine that fit the characters that I was talking about throughout the verses. When I say Black Smitty used to post up on the wall, every time he bust a head, told me look out for them laws. Peanut and Teddy used to drink that Parmesan, had a plethora of hoes and taught me how to talk to broads. Black Smitty. Smitty was a cousin of mine that I grew up with on 34th and Norton. Smitty was a cousin. Black Smitty was dark. Black Smitty used to post up on the wall every time he bust a head, told me look out for them laws. Smitty used to hustle. He was a hustler, you know what I'm saying? And so I used people that was relatives of mine that fit the category of the characters that I'm talking about in the song. Peanut and Teddy used to drink that Parmesan, had a plethora of hoes and taught me how to talk to broads. These was two cousins of mine, Peanut and Teddy, that also stayed on Norton off of 34th. And these was cousins. Peanut, you know what I'm saying? He's been through the lifestyle to where he's had money. He's a slick talker, smooth talker, not slick, but a smooth talker, man, and could talk to the women, you know what I'm saying? Some people would consider him a Mac or a Playboy. That's how I viewed him when I was younger, you know, like a Mac or a Playboy. And, him and Teddy, you know what I'm saying? They had the women. And of course, you know, they drank. Was it specifically Parmesan? Who knows? But I just know that they drank, but they fit the character for, you know, what I was talking about in the song. Hit the world hoes and taught me how to talk to broad. My nigga Chess, he knew how to fix your car, smoke crack and entertain, as that nigga did it all. I got a cousin named Chess, you know what I'm saying? His drug of choice was, you know what I'm saying, was coke, crack cocaine or whatever, but I don't judge him for that, because Chess, he could be high, just as high as he want to be, and can fix your car better than any professional corporation that you can go to. So Chess, you know, he can get high and he can fix your car, can tell you about anything on your car that was broken or needed fixed. If you needed something done and you needed to go the cheap route, Chess could do it. You know what I'm saying? And Anuba Ray had the gallons of the water, supplied the whole city. He was what you call a baller. Anuba Ray is my uncle. Called him Uber Ray, and he had a name for himself back in the days, you know what I'm saying? He was he had the PCP, he was selling the water, you know what I'm saying? He had a big name back in Kansas City back in the days, and if you needed some water, he was the majority of the one that you went to get it. And I say gallons of that water, I ain't talking about H2O, I'm talking about PCP, the kind you dip your brown Moore cigarette in and you smoke it and you light it up. And it's like embalming fluid that the morticians use, embalming fluid cut with various other things. We sold it. They sold it, and they had a red pack of cigarettes that was called Moors, Moore Reds. They was brown. The package was red. The cigarettes was long, skinny brown cigarettes, man. And you dip that in there, and you pull down the liquid. You pull down that PCP. You take that filter off, and you light it. And, you know, PCP, for people that's out there that's done PCP before, know what I'm talking about. When I say gallons of it, he used to have gallons of it. And I ain't trying to put him out there, but it was so long ago, he ain't gonna get in no trouble right now. But I used him, had the gallons of that water, supplied the whole city. He was what you call a baller. I learned to hustle crack and watch for police and talk clever to get a chick to do whatever I need. Had to hook up with a mechanic who would barter for free. He had the baller that I can call to set me up in these streets. So once again, all those people I named, Black Smitty, Peanut, Teddy, Chess, Uber Ray, I learned specific things from each one of those. I learned individual things that I applied to my life. And that's what I'm talking about when I say that. And and that alone taught me how to be a man. See, my daddy wasn't home, so I learned where I can. Right or wrong, I looked at it as a plan. You can judge me if you want. I knew how to make them ends meet. Meaning, you know, I may not have been living the right way, and my view on life may not have been going in the right direction, but I did what I had to do in order for me to survive. Whether that was knowing how to talk to certain chicks to get what I needed, you know what I'm saying? Having my way with certain women, you know what I'm saying? I'm not proud of it now, but that was me being a survivor, being that it wasn't modeled in front of me how to treat women and how to be with a woman. I know that now, you know what I'm saying? But back then, you know, these are in my late teens, early 20s, you know what I'm saying? This is how I was moving. I learned how to sell stuff, sell drugs, sell dope, you know what I'm saying? I jumped in that life for a while, you know what I'm saying? Until I got shot and this and that, you know what I'm saying, to where I stopped. But I lived the dope life, you know what I'm saying, where I was selling crack, I sold weed, I sold PCP, you know what I'm saying, and I learned it from, at the time, who was the best to do it, you know what I'm saying? I had a car, I needed it fixed, I couldn't afford or didn't want to spend a lot of money going some place that was going to rip you off, you know what I'm saying? I went to Chess, you know what I'm saying, and he fixed the car, you know what I'm saying? And so I used those characters, my relatives, in that verse to explain what I'm talking about when you're down by the liquor store and all these characters that are around there that you can learn stuff from, especially if you ain't got a daddy in your house. So that's what that verse is for, you know what I'm saying? Moving to the second verse. Let me see. Alright, so moving to the second verse, y'all. I hope I got you tuned in. I hope it's interesting. I hope it's some stuff that I can teach you that you never knew. You know what I'm saying? Down by the liquor store.
Trust a nigga made me carry a piece. Lil Lumpy was in the game, had me red as a cheat. Introduced me into the bloods, now I'm ready for beef.
My homie Berkey used to lay in the crease. Taught me never to trust a nigga, made me carry a piece. Lil Lumpy was in the gang, had me read as a chief. Introduced me into the bloods, now I'm ready for beef. Berkey was another relative of mine, another family member. Berkey was a cousin of mine, and he used to hustle and do what he had to do. And Berkey and Lumpy, you know what I'm saying? Berkey and Lumpy is people. This is all relatives, you know what I'm saying? All my relatives, all my cousins, and they're all off of Norton, you know what I'm saying? And I chose to use them, like I said before, is because they fit the characters that I was writing for this song, you know what I'm saying? I was younger than them, and I seen them coming up hustling, they was making money, you know what I'm saying? And I sat back and watched them, you know what I'm saying? And Berkey used to land the crease. Berkey wasn't, you know what I'm saying? Berkey kind of just sat back and just was kind of a cool dude, you know what I'm saying? Getting his money. He wasn't a loud type of guy, you know what I'm saying? He made his money. He sat back in the cuts or whatever. And he came to my mind when I started writing for this second verse. And Lumpy. Lumpy was my cousin. Lumpy was a little bit more wilder. He was younger, you know what I'm saying? Lumpy was considered the baby of all the kids or whatever, but he was the wild boy, you know what I'm saying? And he was a blood dude, you know what I'm saying? He was the one that had me turn towards living that blood gang lifestyle. Lumpy, you know what I'm saying? That's my relative off of 34th and Norton. And you know, had me read as a chief, introduced me into the bloods. Now I'm ready for beef. You know what I'm saying? Once I made the decision to go that route and which gang that I wanted to be a part of, you know what I'm saying? You know, gangs is nothing but wanting some unity or wanting to feel accepted. And once I did that, you know what I'm saying? That was the route that I went, and I had a relative to show me right there in my face, you know what I'm saying? Which way that I wanted to go. You know what I'm saying? I'd been jumped by Crips before, whatever. When I found out what gangs was, you know, I found out late. I found out in my ninth grade year, you know, what gangs was or whatever. I even used to wear blue, you know what I'm saying? People would try to tell you, our cut used to wear blue, he used to be a Crip. I ain't never been a Crip, but I did wear blue because I didn't know what gangs was. You know, I grew up, not knowing what gangs was. And when gangs hit here in Kansas City, I didn't know what it was. And yeah, I was wearing blue, but I never claimed Crip. But, when I had a run in with some Crips because I was wearing red, didn't know what it was for until I found out like a year later what that was about. And, you know, when I heard that, I instantly wanted to be a blood. And I had somebody that modeled that in front of me, you know, not on purpose. He was just being himself, but that was my relative. And it was a certain part of him that I looked up to, and I chose to live the blood life. And, you know, hence Bloody Cuddy, you know what I'm saying? That's where it derived from. You know, back when I was young, man, I was like 15, 16 years old. And, I've been claiming blood gang ever since, blood affiliation, you know what I'm saying? And so that's where that derived from. Introduced me into the bloods. Now I'm ready for beef. Then I say,
this other nigga June used to help me about my grades, told me I should stay in school. He had a scholarship but thought that it was cool to drop out and sell some dope, told me that I had to choose.
But on a different note, this other nigga June used to help me about my grades, told me I should stay in school. He had a scholarship and thought that it was cool to drop out and sell some dope, told me that I had to choose. Now, June is not a cousin of mine. June is my uncle's name, my daddy's brother. And, I just used his name, but my Uncle June, I don't know too much about his childhood, except for he was a wild boy too in these streets. You know what I'm saying? He was running wild back in his day, in his heyday. But I used him because I wanted to still use family members that fit the description of that. And from what I know about my Uncle June's life, you know what I'm saying? He was a wild boy. But if Uncle June would give me advice, he would want me to stay in school, you know what I'm saying? And if I was gonna be hustling, you can't do school and you can't have good grades or whatever and still try to sell dope and do the wrong thing, you know what I'm saying? You can only go one way or this way, you know what I'm saying? So, you know what I'm saying? He was like, you either go be in this 100%, or you go be in this 100%. You go do dope, or you go sell dope, or you go do school and get your school life on and get your education on. And me having them other cousins from the first verse and everything that I've learned, you know what I'm saying, everything that I picked up, I feel like I can do them both. You know what I'm saying? Oh man, I messed up and took it all the way back. Here we go. Thought that it was cool to drop out and sell some dope, told me that I had to choose. I chose them both cause I was already on him. I chose them both cause I was already on. Had too many people influencing me now to get caught. And I'm taking care of my mama, I'm the man in my house. Had to grow up before my time, now I'm the man in my route. Meaning, you know, I had so many people in my life that was an influence that I'm gonna be going to school and I'm gonna be hustling and selling some dope and some drugs, trying to make some money too. And you know, my mom had been on drugs in and out throughout my life from age 10 up till I was 28 years old. And so, you know, I'm buying things for the house. I'm 15, 16 years old, you know what I'm saying, 17 years old, and I'm taking care of the house. You know, I'm giving her money for groceries or you know what I'm saying, I'm giving her money for certain things that she may need. And sometimes I'm sure I was giving her money for her to go do her thing in the streets or whatever, but that made me grow up fast, you know what I'm saying? I had to mature real fast, didn't really get to enjoy my childhood. And so, that's what I mean by that, you know, taking care of my mama, I'm the man in my route. Yeah, and that alone taught me how to be a man. I say, and my daddy wasn't home, so I knew how to make them ends meet, you know what I'm saying? Down by the liquor store, you know what I'm saying? So I did what I had to do. I had to grow up fast. I was taking care of my own house. You know what I'm saying? I was the man of my house at a young age when I wasn't supposed to be, didn't know what a man was. But, you know, I did what I had to survive. I did what I had to ensure that, you know, we can have the things that we needed and that we kept a roof over our heads. You know what I'm saying? And that's what that was all about. Moving into the third verse.
Had too many people influence. There's a plan you can judge. Our father figures got found by the last day is right now.
Now, moving into the third verse, we're going to it like this.
Down by the liquor store is all about.
about survival. Go to jail or in the bed, depending on who was your rival. My nigga Buster quoted scriptures from the Bible. Kept the nigga with the conscience, never making nothing idle. I got arrested.
All right. Down by the liquor store was all about survival. Go to jail or end up dead, depending on who was your rivals. My nigga Buster quoted scriptures from the Bible, kept the nigga with the conscience, never making nothing idols. So down by the liquor store was all about survival. You hanging out by the liquor store, you know what I'm saying? You doing drugs, you selling drugs, you drinking some liquor, you selling some liquor, you selling some weed, you hustling. You know what I'm saying? Now it's all about survival. Go to jail or end up dead. Now you can get caught while you're trying to do all this illegal activity or whatever down there by the liquor store, from what I witnessed and what I seen coming up in life, or you can end up dead. You know, when you're in the streets and you're doing stuff like that, you make enemies. People get jealous of you. You can have enemies without personally or blatantly making enemies. You know, people just see you on the come up and want what you have. You know what I'm saying? They don't want to do it themselves. They rather take it from you. They're looking for the quick buck, the quick come up or whatever. So that's what I mean by go to jail or end up dead, depending on who was your rivals. You know, my nigga Buster. Now Buster was another cousin of mine off of Norton. Buster quoted scriptures from the Bible. That's the type of guy Buster was. You know, you see Buster or whatever, and Buster was the type of guy that when he got you one-on-one talking to you, whatever, his talk was a little bit different. This convo was a little bit different than the rest of my cousins. Buster kind of talked and talked and kind of made sense. May have not been living the right life or whatever, but he had knowledge of the right things to do. That's why I say you can never kind of judge a person by what they're doing and how they're looking or whatever. You never know what type of stuff that they can tell you. So moving forward in life, don't never judge a book by its cover. Even though a person might not be living right, if you're having a conversation with them, listen to what they're saying. And what you do is you take the things in that apply to you, and then you dispose of the things that, you know what I'm saying, that aren't beneficial to you. And that's what I was writing about with Buster. My nigga Buster quoted scriptures from the Bible, kept the nigga with the conscience, never making nothing idols, meaning that I had a conscience, you know what I'm saying? I ain't never wanted to kill nobody. I ain't never put money as a priority in my life. You got people that just are greedy and just, you know, make money the most important thing in life, or make whatever, clothing, cars, rims, anything that you put before God, you know what I'm saying, makes it an idol in your life. An idol is anything that you put that's more important than giving God your attention or giving God your all. Now, I ain't saying that I was all on my spiritual journey back then, but you know, money was never a big deal to me. I seen so many people around me just chase that money. And when you're chasing the money, you're gonna always be chasing it because it'll never be enough. You know what I'm saying? You can say, man, when I get 50 G's, then I'm gonna stop. You get that 50 G's and you're gonna be like, man, this ain't enough. I want more. And it's just gonna keep happening and happening and happening because you're making money your idol. And as long as you make money your idol, God said he will cut the pockets of the wicked man, meaning no matter how much money you got, you will never have enough and you'll always be chasing it. And that goes for anything, whether it's liquor, whether it's drugs, you know what I'm saying, whether it's women, whether it's cars, whether it's just nice things. Anything that you make an idol is something that you put above God, you will never be satisfied or whatever. And so I never put money before God or put money as a priority in my life. Not even having nice things, I like to have them, but I never made something so important that, you know, it ruined my life. Never. You know what I'm saying? And I'm not going to sit here and say that because I kept God first, I'll be lying. So I'm not going to sit here and lie. This is the Truth Be Told series. I'm not going to sit here and lie, but I will say I never did make none of those things a priority in my life. I just kind of did what I did at whatever time that it benefited me. You know what I'm saying? So yeah, that's how that goes or whatever. And then I continue to say,
I got shot, but it was never over.
I got arrested, but it was never over drugs. I got shot, but it was never over bloods. I did time, nothing short of several months. Owe it all to my liquor store, niggas can't front. So what I mean is, I've been arrested before. I've been arrested quite a few times, you know what I'm saying? I'm no angel. And what I mean, I got arrested, but it was never over drugs, meaning all the times that I've been to jail, when I was out of town selling dope, you know what I'm saying? Or when I was when I've got arrested here in the city where I live at, you know, in Kansas City, Missouri, when I've had drugs on me and when I was selling drugs. When I went to jail, it was never for drugs. I've always went to jail child support. I went to jail for missing a court date for child support. I'd be in jail, you know what I'm saying? I'd be in jail for, it's been times I've been in jail for months, you know what I'm saying? And I'm in there with people who sold dope, got cases, or they on their way to prison for murdering somebody, and I'd be in there because I got arrearages on child support, or I missed my court date, you know what I'm saying? So I've never been arrested over drugs. When I was out of town selling dope up in St. Joseph, been arrested, you know what I'm saying? Me and my best friends at the time had been arrested, been in the police station with drugs on me that they didn't find, and money in my shoe, you know what I'm saying? But they was just harassing us because we was up in their town, and they knew what we was doing, but they never could catch us doing it, you know what I'm saying? And so by the grace of God, I never was arrested for selling drugs, especially out of town, because I still be in jail right now. You know what I'm saying? St. Joe did not play. They catch you with one dime piece and your butt go be doing 20 years, you know what I'm saying? So I got shot, but it was never over Bloods, meaning I got shot. The two times I got shot, one of them was in St. Joe in 96, you know what I'm saying? I got shot in the back or whatever, and it wasn't over no blood gang stuff. It was over a misunderstanding with somebody thinking that I was on the opposing side of an argument. That was that one time, and then the second time I got shot was definitely not over gangs. It was somebody I thought was a good friend of mine, and we had a little fight, and he pulled out a gun, and I got the best of him. He pulled out a gun, and I learned real quick that he wasn't a friend that I thought he was, you know what I'm saying? And I got shot three times on that occasion, you know what I'm saying? It had nothing to do with gangs. And so I got shot, but it was never over Bloods. I did time, nothing short of several months. Owe it all to my liquor store niggas came front, meaning I've been to jail, but like I told you, it was never over no drugs, and it was never over gangs, you know what I'm saying? It's always been over something that was totally aside from that, that didn't give me no hard time. Owe it all to my liquor store niggas came front, meaning every character I was talking about or metaphorically the people that I'm using around the liquor store environment that I'm talking about, meaning I sucked up all these individual things from people that had an influence in my life that it allowed me to stay out of detrimental trouble, or to stay out of harm's way throughout the time that I wasn't living my life to the best of my ability. So that's what I say, I owe it all to my liquor store niggas came from. And so I proceed to say after that,
so check this.
I love my daddy, but he wasn't at home. Forced the nigga to take advice from other men on my own. I don't blame him, I can't relate, especially now that I'm grown. Got some kids who ain't in my life, I know they singing this song. Yeah, meaning I love my pops, man. I've never had resentment for him or whatever. I told you, at any opportunity I got, I went and kicked it with my pops. He made me laugh all the time. He used to work out. He inspired me to be strong, to be athletic. And to this very day, he is the reason that I try to stay in shape so that I can someday, hopefully, that I'm blessed and graced enough, you know what I'm saying, to look like how my pops look. I love my daddy, but he wasn't at home. Forced me to take advice from other men on my own, meaning he wasn't in my life, and I knew it wasn't necessarily all of his fault, because it takes two, you know what I'm saying, my mom and my daddy, however that goes. But check this, he wasn't in my life raising me or whatever, so when I was out on the streets, there was other people that I looked to and took advice from, or I didn't have to talk to them, but I watched how they move. You know, I picked up things from other men out there, you know what I'm saying, as a means to survival and as a means to, you know what I'm saying, to live and move in order for me to survive and do and get the things that I needed done, you know what I'm saying? And then I say, I got some kids who ain't in my life, I know they singing this song. I love my daddy, buddy, wounded at home. I'm a nigga to take advice from other men of my own. I don't blame him. I can't relate, especially now that I'm grown. Meaning, now that I have had kids and I went through the whole baby mama drama stuff and wasn't with the mother of the kid that I had, and she was never a girlfriend or a potential wife, now I understand how things go. You know what I'm saying? Things happen. You live this life, you live young, dumb, and reckless, and then you got to deal with the consequences of having a child out of wedlock, and then you got to deal with, you know, having a baby mama, and you know what I'm saying? And then you get child support put on you, and then you and the mama ain't getting along, and so to spite you, you know what I'm saying, she does things to try to harm you and this and that. And you know, I had multiple kids by the time I was 22, you know what I'm saying, and so I was dealing with baby mama drama, you know what I'm saying. I had some kids who went in my life. I know they sang in this song. Ah, man. I love my daddy when he wasn't at home. Forced a nigga to take advice from other kids of my own. I don't blame him. I can't relate, especially now that I'm grown. Got some kids who ain't in my life. I know they singing this song. So I'm sorry I got off track. So yeah, I got them kids. And so I understand what my daddy may have went through, because now I got kids of my own. And I've had to live some of the things that my daddy probably had to go through with me, with my mom. You know what I'm saying? And so now as I've gotten older, even though I never held resentment toward him, now I can actually see, like, hey, it ain't 100% his fault. Or I can understand my mama could have been a capital B, you know what I'm saying, with him, you know what I'm saying? Because now I've experienced that with my kids' moms, you know what I'm saying? The mothers can be some capital B's, man, you know what I'm saying? And so now I know I don't have no resentment towards my father. Now I know how it can be. Now that I got kids of my own, I see it from a different perspective, you know what I'm saying? Got some kids who ain't in my life. I know they singing this song, meaning didn't have a daddy around. The same way I'm saying I didn't have a daddy around, I know that I got some grown kids now, a couple of them, you know what I'm saying, who feel the same way I felt when I'm saying, you know what I'm saying, my daddy wasn't in my life, you know what I'm saying, and I got to be grown, and I'm out here, and my daddy wasn't in my life, and so I got to take advice from some other men, you know what I'm saying. I got a boy and a daughter who ain't in consistently in my life right now that are grown. I love them to death. I've reached out to them, and they haven't responded back, you know what I'm saying. They got resentment, and I've talked to them before, and I gave them the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, and I explained to them how they was created, how they came about, how I met their mothers, and what it led up to, and why things wasn't like this and like that, and you know what I'm saying, thought that we had a mutual understanding of everything, and you know, they still chose to you know, saying to have resentment or whatever, and you know, what can I do, what can I say? I mean, I know I was in the streets, and I was young and dumb, and wasn't a mature person enough to be a parent, you know what I'm saying, doing what I could do, but didn't know what it was to be a parent, because it wasn't modeled in front of me, you know, and I take full blame for that. You know, I'm not just gonna say that was on my daddy and that was on my mama, you know what I'm saying. And some of these choices I made logically, and I chose to, you know, continue to do music and to run wild and just to live reckless or whatever, because, you know, that's what I was doing and that's all I knew. But yeah, I got some kids, man, that I haven't talked to in a while, you know what I'm saying? And I know that if they've heard this song, they like, they can relate, you know what I'm saying? I know they singing this song. So that alone taught me how to be a man. See, my daddy wasn't home, so I learned where I can. So do it right. Teach your boy to be a man, and by any means necessary, with a God-fearing plan. Now, I did my first part of my life, I lived it the wrong way. I didn't have a father that was in the house raising me. And I took advice from other men. I did what I did. You know what I'm saying? And so I can keep blaming my childhood or keep blaming the absence of my father on it, but that wouldn't make sense, and that would just be me being having a cop-out type of moment. I'm not gonna have a cop-out type of moment. I'm gonna take responsibility and be held accountable for my own actions. I made some mistakes, and I made some wrong decisions, and I can be responsible for that. I hold myself responsible. But now I got another little one, as you see him trying to creep down the stairs. I got another little one now. So am I gonna still use, I didn't have that in front of me, it wasn't modeled in front of me? Or am I gonna look back, reflect on my life, and understand that everything that we do in life comes based off of a decision. A decision to do what you know is right, even if you don't know exactly what it all entails, or a decision to do something wrong. And so now, here's my second chance to do everything right. I'm instilling in him everything that I didn't get. I'm giving to him everything that I didn't get. I'm showing love and showing responsibilities and morals and how to treat a woman and how to be to a lady and how to be out here in this world and how to hold himself accountable for what he does and how he thinks. I'm giving all these things to him that wasn't personally given to me, but what I've learned over the years through my trials and tribulations, through my ups and downs, through my wrong choices, you know what I'm saying? And so it still wasn't modeled in front of me how to be a dad, but with the help of God, my Lord and Savior, you know what I'm saying? He's the dad that I didn't get. You know what I'm saying? Reading that Bible is giving me the knowledge that I need. With the help of the Holy Spirit, he leads me in the right direction to be able to give him what I didn't get. And at the end of the day, even if you're not in the Bible, if you want to be a good parent, it don't come with a rule book or no guidelines. You want to be a good parent, all you got to do is give your child what you would have wanted when you was that kid, especially if you didn't have a parent, a mother or a father. Give your kid what you would have wanted when you was little. And that's the first step. And everything else, man, will start falling into place. You know what I'm saying? And so that's down by the liquor store. And I hope I shed some light. I hope I gave you all a different perspective. I've shared some personal things that has happened with me in my life. And I'm not ashamed of them, man. Like I said, my truths could somehow be a blessing to you. That's the only blessing that I need, man. I'd like to thank you all for tuning in on the sixth week covering by the liquor store. Those are my truths, and I hope that they have helped you. And if you didn't need this information, hopefully you know somebody who it may help or whatever. You know what I'm saying? Let my truths being told be a blessing to you or somebody else. Thank you for coming out. Thank you for tuning in. Not only subscribe to the channel, but if you want to stay up to date, every time I got one of these series going on, I want you to go ahead and hit that notification button. That way, anytime I do something, whether it's a music video or whether it's one of these videos, you'll get notified. So hit the notification button as well as the subscribe button, man. And holler back at your boy next week when we cover truth. And who's going to be with me? The last lady. That's right. Angie Calhoun is going to be with me, man. And we're going to share some very, very vulnerable, some very, very personal moments that has happened in our life, man. So tune in, but you won't be able to tune in on time unless you hit that notification button. So hit that notification button along with subscribing, man, and let this be a blessing to you and somebody else. I'm Cut Calhoun. Thanks for tuning in to week six. We covered by the liquor store, Truth Be Told, Meaning Behind the Music series. Holla at your boy, and we go right on out with some music. Thank you everybody for tuning in. Good luck, lessons, and God bless. Let's ride out to this.
How to be a man. See, my daddy wasn't home, so I learned where I can. So do it right, teach your boy to be a man. If by any means needed, with the God that I plan. Right down by the liquor store, they used to huddle right round on the liquor store. Our father figures got found by the liquor store. Became a man on down by the liquor store. We met our status right down by the liquor store. They used to huddle right round on the liquor store.
I love this boy, y'all. I love this boy. Say, truth be told.
Truth be told.
Catch us next time.
And if you want to hear my dad, subscribe and comment down below.
All right. Boom. Give me a dab. Pow. We out, y'all. Holla.